Hey, brothers and sisters! Greeting in the name of the Lord, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. Praise the living God, brothers and sisters. I just wanted to make a video and just say praise God. May the Lord bless all of you. I thank all of you who watch my videos, who pray for Joshua's ministry, who pray for me. To God be the glory. Great things He has done. Hallelujah. For God is the one to do all things, brothers and sisters, through us, His children, His vessels, His servants. Praise God for His grace and His mercy and His love. And as the Lord Jesus told us at the end of the Gospel of John, He said, remember, you know, you didn't choose me. I choose you. And I called you. And so praise God. And then the Lord, you know, as He went along the Sea of Galilee, He said to all of His disciples, He said, follow me. And I will make you fishers of men. So praise God, brothers and sisters. I can't remember if I made a video of what I might get into or not. I was trying to remember because the Lord is reminding me of a message. But first I want to say this. As I mentioned before, and the Lord had given me a change of my doctrine and understanding of who would be raptured. And I made a video called The Lord Showed Me Who Would Be Raptured. And praise God, brothers and sisters, I don't know how or why other than the Lord, but for some reason, you know, over 120,000 people have seen that video. So praise God. Because it was a shift in what the Lord had been showing me. And that, brothers and sisters, is that the 10 virgins is referring to the church and referring to the rapture, brothers and sisters. And I had suspected before and read, we're in Revelation chapter 3, that the Lord only promised one church, the Philadelphia church. Revelation 3:10, He said, because you have kept the word of my patience, or you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth to try all the people on the earth. Now, brothers and sisters, there's 7 churches. And He only said that to one, to the church age that we are living in. Now, almost all of these scholars, you know, these high theologians, they agree that each church, not only was it a literal church in the time that John wrote it, there in Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey, it's also, brothers and sisters, referring to different ages of the church. And so we, brothers and sisters, are living in that last church age, known as the Laodicean church, the lukewarm church. Now, brothers and sisters, I've mentioned this before. Many of you maybe didn't see it. Did you know that the place of Laodicea, because God always, the Lord, God Almighty, He always says things literal and then figurative, and then He also does it in a parable way. Parable means to throw alongside of, like a paramedic is alongside of medical doctors. Paralegal is alongside of an attorney. So a parable, a bola, is to throw alongside of. So a parable is not the exact thing, but an image or a reflection of things that are from above, things earthly that reflect things from above. And that's the other message I want to give about, that's the other message. The Lord has got me lined up to bring it together, but let me finish this one first. So brothers and sisters, what the Lord has shown me is that, and that Laodicean church age, brothers and sisters, Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. He's knocking at the door of the church. He's talking to the Laodicean church. And people always use that text to evangelize people, and there's nothing wrong with that, to say, you know, the Lord is knocking at the door of your heart, which is also true. But in the text, the surface text, at the first meaning, the Lord is standing at the door of the Laodicean church and knocking. He said, if any man opens to me and lets me in, I will sup with him and he will sup with me. King James, I'll eat with him. He'll dine with me. We will commune together. That's why communion is to commune with the Lord, to break bread with the Lord. Hallelujah. To sit down at his table. You know, like at the Last Supper. He said that I will not eat this and drink this fruit of the vine anymore till I eat it there in heaven with you. I don't want to get into it. There's a sister, you know, there's all kinds of demonic, you know, the downside of the of social media is that any clown can get on there and say that, oh, the church is not the bride. There will be no marriage supper of the Lamb. All the people mentioned in Revelation is really the Israelites. That's nothing to do with the church. I have people almost every day, I just want to say this, because I told the sister, you know, I would pray that the Lord would lead me to mention it. That is why it says, I know the downside of the social media is there's anarchy. you know. And the downside of the church is we got people who are in authority in churches, like the Pope or, you know, the Archbishop of Canterbury, who is saying that they should have Sharia law in England for Muslims, and he let the Muslims come in there and do prayers in the, you know, there in the Church of England and all that. So the downside when you have religious leaders who are corrupt, who are Jesuits, who are evil, whose philosophy is anti-Christ, individual. You know, it's individuals, brothers and sisters. Individuals. So when you have individual corrupt church leaders, like the current Pope, who is a Jesuit, as an example, individually, you know, we can't sit there. I mean, I'm shifting topics here. I want to say this. You can't sit there and throw, you know, a whole denomination in the garbage can. Now, I have personally met people from almost any denomination you can think of who were truly born again. But why they continue to go into the devil's den, to that church, is something that's between them and God. We have to warn them to come out and flee from them. And it is also true, I've said this before, I'll say it again, God never leaves some group without a witness. God always says in his word, and Jesus quoted also from the law, let everything be established by two or more witnesses. So therefore, wouldn't it be logical that God would have born-again Christians in the Catholic Church, because they're there as a witness to the vast majority who are not saved, who are Mary worshipers, idol worshipers. But God has his people there. God would not leave all of those people that never heard anything or knew anything different without a witness, because our God is love. Our God, our Lord Jesus Christ, said that he, what shepherd, it's a parable, who has 100 sheep, and one sheep is lost, will not leave those 99 sheep and go after the one. And when he finds the one, he will make a celebration and say, look, I found that one sheep that was lost and I brought it home. Not even getting excited that the 99 that didn't leave, just like the parable of the prodigal son. The father was excited when his son who was lost was found again. He wasn't excited for his other son who never went anywhere. Does that negate his other son? No. He's saying, hey, this son of mine who was about to destroy his life, who was about to be lost forever, decided to come home, and he rejoiced in that. He even took the shoes off of his feet and took a ring off his hand and put it on his son. That's our God. He loves the world, for God so loved the world. God loves the world, and he wishes none to perish, but all to come to the saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Therefore, the Lord puts his witnesses in all places. Hallelujah. Even in the where prostitutes are, where drugs are, where alcohol is. The problem with lots of us Christians, I mean, God didn't call you to that. Lots of people say, well, you know, we shouldn't go here and shouldn't go there. God didn't call you there. Go back and be, you know, go preach to the choir, as they say. Be salt and light among each other. Let's don't go out in the world. I mean, that's the problem. I came out of the Baptist denomination, and that's the biggest problem I have with the Baptist denomination. Not the fact that they blaspheme the Holy Spirit every day, in my opinion, and they, you know, deny that God is the same today, yesterday, and forever, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. They deny that Bible verse and think that God changed the way he operates in the power of the Holy Spirit from the end of the Bible being written. The problem I have is every Sunday they preach to each other, amen, I'm glad I'm saved, I'm glad I'm saved, I'm not. I'm glad we're not like those people outside. I'm glad we're not going to hell like everybody else outside this building but us. Everybody's going to hell but us, praise God. I got saved on July 23rd, 1982, right there at that altar, right in the front, praise God, I got saved. Once saved, always saved, I know I'm going to heaven, forgiven of all sins, past, present, and future, praise God. Too bad about, you know, those people out there. Those homosexuals are going to hell. Those, you know, Catholics are going to hell. Everybody's going to hell. To each other. God said, I give you power. The Lord Jesus Christ said, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you shall receive power. Dynamite is the modern word from dunamis, what Jesus said in the Greek. You shall receive power from on high when the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. For what purpose? To do signs and wonders? No. That's the result of the power of God. Signs and wonders following. To be a witness. You shall receive power from on high when the Holy Ghost comes upon you to be a witness to me. To Judea, Jerusalem, Judea, to Samaria and to the othermost parts of the world. Hallelujah. God has anointed us with power that we might be a witness. To who is Jesus Christ? A witness to what? To Jesus. Now, brothers and sisters, the Lord is leading me to say this because, you know, I'm giving those people words. And this is the gift of the word of wisdom or word of knowledge, which I explained. Word of wisdom is what to do with the knowledge you got. The word of knowledge is God says he knows you've been struggling with your finances. Wisdom. Reap and you shall, you know, you reap what you sow. What the Bible says. The Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, you know, if you bring your tithes and give, and let's translate that into the New Testament. Give and it shall be given unto you, Jesus said. In good measure, pressed down and running over, shall men give in, you know, shaking together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you measure, it'll be measured back to you. Jesus uses that same idea when he talks about in Matthew chapter 7, judge not, lest you be judged. Because with the same measure you judge with, it'll be, you'll be judged by the same standard you apply to others, it'll be put back on you. Whatever you give, with the measure you give, it'll be given back to you. 30, 60, 100-fold. That's all true. You know, don't throw out the fact that God wants to bless us, you know, with the prosperity gospel people. Don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Just, it's the same topic. I guess that's the message that the Lord is giving me right now. You know, don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Don't throw out God's people with the trash. God's got his people everywhere. God's got his people everywhere. You know, there's Muslims that God has preordained to be saved at the right time, at the right moment, to be his witnesses so that those people will be without excuse. Those people who are Muslims, who are jihadists and all that stuff, there are Muslims. I know, as a matter of fact, I personally know Filipino pastors who were Muslims, who were members of terrorist organization right here on Mindanao Island where I am today. I know those pastors, and when they got saved, they witnessed to their fellow terrorist group members, the MILIF is one of the groups here, the Moro Independent, whatever, Liberation Front here in Mindanao, and they beat them up and tried to kill them for their witness for Jesus Christ. But still, even though they tried to kill them, just like Paul, who held the coats of people who stoned Stephen, Acts chapter 8, Saul of Tarsus, the Apostle Paul, same person, he endorsed them killing Stephen, but later on he became the most prolific writer in the New Testament. God had a witness. God had a witness. God sowed Stephen into the ground to reap the Apostle Paul. That's how much the Lord wanted those Bible books to be written. Stephen was martyred for that. Go search it out. So these men here who are now brothers in Christ, and how many more of them actually lost their life that we don't know about because they were killed by these Muslim terrorists. But some survived. They were able to escape. And then their pastors in other parts of Mindanao Island in a non-Muslim controlled area, they're pastors now in different denominations. Some of them are Baptists. Some of them are Assemblies of God. I know three or four different ones. Praise God. Praise God. God had them there that, you know, all along. And from the foundation of the world, he knew who they were, who they were going to be, and he raised them up. You know, even today, when the rapture happens, brothers and sisters, there are people who are born again, who have not left their dead denomination, like Catholics or Presbyterians or whatever, Lutherans and whatnot, they are going to be activated by God when the rapture happens. Those lukewarm Christians who are mingling, co-mingling, they're going to say, hey, this is what's spoken of in the Word of God, that the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the air. But guess what? We missed it. Because what I came on here to say at the beginning of this video was that Jesus told the disciples to follow him. And that's where all these denominations are wrong. They think being a Christian means that they said a prayer one time. They went to confirmation classes at the Catholic Church, Lutheran and all that, and they had a confirmation ceremony. Somebody sprinkled water on the head, and they think that means they're a Christian. But to be a Christian means follower of Jesus Christ. That's why one of the greatest examples in the Bible of a type and a shadow and a parable and a throw alongside of the rapture is Enoch. Because in Genesis it says that Enoch walked with God and he was no more. Why? Because God took him. So if you want to be raptured, it's a one-line thing. Walk with God. Unless you're walking with God, he's not going to take you. What does that mean? I'm Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. If I'm following Jesus, as it says in Amos 3:3, how can two walk together except they be in agreement? So if I'm pro-abortion, I'm not in agreement with Jesus Christ, and therefore I'm not following him. Understand? I have relatives who say they're Christian, but they're pro-gay marriage. They're pro-abortion. They voted for Obama. They love Obama. All this other stuff for legalization of any kind of drug, and I can't even begin to scratch the surface of what they believe. That's just a sketch. And they are not walking in agreement with Christ. They are not walking and being followers of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And what is the Lord's commandments? What does it say in James? It says in James that perfect religion is to keep yourself spotless from the world and minister to widows and orphans. In other words, give charity, do charity work, give yourself in the name of Christ to help other people with your time, your treasure, your talents. Give to the kingdom of God. Offer yourself, as Romans chapter 12, as a living sacrifice acceptable unto God. That is following Jesus. Do what the Lord led you to do in your life. That's why people, all the years I ministered to Filipinos and the churches I planted in the States, people always that I've dealt with as a pastor, they always say, Pastor Patrick, well, of course, because that's my name. They say, Pastor Patrick, maybe they call me some other name. They say, some bad name. They say to me, Pastor Patrick, I've got this situation that's going on in my life. What do I need to do in this situation? You know, it's like the old saying, you know, teach a man to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. Give him a fish, he'll eat for today. People want to be given a fish when the Lord wants you to learn how to fish. If you knew the Lord and you knew his word, you would know what to do. And in those questions of uncertainty, it says in Romans, which I've quoted this a million times, Romans chapter 8, verse 14, it says, verse 16, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. These are the children of God. To be raptured, to be saved, is to be a child of God. And therefore, if you're a child of God, you're supposed to be led by the Spirit. His Spirit, the other verse that I did, Romans 8, 14 and 16, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. To be a Christian means to be a child of God. John chapter 1, it says, to those who believe on his name, to them he gave power to become the children of God. Jesus, if you believe on him and believe on his name and you believe and put your faith, your hope and trust in the finished work of Christ for your salvation, then you become a child of God. John chapter 1. And if a child of God, Romans chapter 8, you're supposed to be led by the Spirit. His Spirit will bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. That's how you know you're a child of God, because his Spirit will tell you. Seek and ye shall find. Ask and it'll be given to you. Knock and it'll be open. Seek. The Bible in the Old Testament, I believe, is Jeremiah. It says, you know, if you seek the Lord with all your heart, you will find me. He says, if you seek me with all your heart, you'll find me. Jeremiah 33:3, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Call upon the name of the Lord while he is near. I believe that's Isaiah, maybe that's 50-something. Call up, I want to say 58, but I don't think so. Call upon the Lord while he is near. He is near. His ear is not too short that he can't hear you, and his arm's not too short that he can't reach down. God is here for you. He's here for us. Seek him while he may be found, because night time is coming, as the Lord Jesus Christ said in his word. Work while there's light, because the night is coming. The day is over, and there is a time coming when there no one can work. May the peace of the Lord be upon you. And I want to say to somebody, the peace be still. Now, that's the thing about it. There's lots of people who they don't have a spiritual ear to hear. They're carnal minded. That's my other video. They're always hearing and perceiving in a carnal way. They don't have an ear to hear. I pray that God would give you the ear to hear, for Jesus said it over and over and over again in the parables. Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, when the Lord is speaking to the seven churches of Asia Minor, he says over and over and over again, to he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. Not your natural ear. So many natural, carnal-minded Christians, alleged Christians. Get over in the Spirit and get out of the flesh. Romans chapter 8, there at the beginning, it says, there is now therefore no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk according to the Spirit, not according to the flesh. Now, these new translations try to take that last part of the verse out, say it's not in the original text. Yes, it is. Keep reading the next few verses. And it says the same thing over again, just in different words. Those who walk by the Spirit, not by the flesh. And this is also a reference to people trying to follow the law and be perfect and be self-righteous. But in this application, what I'm talking to you now, walk according to the Spirit of God. Follow after the things of God. Set your mind on things above. Take your mind off things below. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And the kingdom of heaven is within us today. And we are about to be within it tomorrow. Praise God, the Lord's coming for his church. For his true bride. I don't care what any, you know, truck driver on Facebook or YouTube says that the church is not the bride and there is no marriage supper of the Lamb. Why is that moving you? If you're set, established and set in the Word of God, no man can move you. Establish yourself in the Word of God. Establish yourself in the Spirit of God. Be not moved. Be not conformed to this world or the words and cunning, enticing words of men that lead silly women astray, as the Bible says. Lead captive, silly women. That's what Paul said. Be rooted and grounded in the Word and in sound doctrine of our living God. Hallelujah. Study to show thyself approved in the Word of God, not in what people say. Read the New Testament yourself and ask the Lord to reveal it to you. Then check yourself by elders, ordained ministers in the church. And as I started to say earlier, as I'm going with this, I talked about anarchy. And I gave the example of, yes, we do need to get away from these false people who are not even Christians, who are not appointed by God, who are in charge of these denominations, that are having, you know, there's a lesbian, whatever, bishop in charge of the Presbyterian USA, whatever. And the Pope, who's a Jesuit, and all these different individuals who are in the spirit of Antichrist. We know that. Yeah, we need to get away from them and not let them lead us into destruction, into perdition like they're going. But in the same hand, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 said he gave some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, teachers, evangelists for the perfecting of the saints. God does anoint people in the offices, in authority in his church. Now there's tons of false, self-appointed and denomination-appointed, unsaved people who are wolves in sheep's clothing in all these denominations. That's a fact. But that don't let an anarchist, unordained, untrained, unanointed, part-time, self-appointed people on YouTube and social media try to establish some new doctrine. They don't even know what they're talking about. It's just out of left field and so bizarre. You know, I don't deal with these people. You cannot convince somebody that's... you know, obviously, like I say, and this is what I ask people who message me sometimes and tell me some wacky doctrine, you know, that it's nothing new under the sun. These doctrines, you know, cults have come up with these doctrines hundreds of years ago. There's schools of Gnosticism and occult doctrines that go back for thousands of years. You know, you can just look it up and see these different, animism, whatever kind of a false doctrine you want to talk about. It's already been through the test of time and scholarly research and prayer over thousands of years. And I ask them, I say, do you know the arrogance or the hubris, the arrogance of people. I ask them, do you go to your doctor's office and also correct him when he's seeing patients? You go in there while he's seeing other patients and try to correct him. Start talking to him while he's seeing patients. Hey, wait a minute, you're doing that wrong. I saw a video on YouTube how to do brain surgery. Let me do some. You know, that's when, you know, when you get some troll comments, it's just like, here I am as a ordained minister ministering what God called me to do. It's the same as someone walking to the doctor's office and saying, excuse me, I read a book about diabetes, and so I'm here to instruct you and teach you and correct you what you're telling your patients about diabetes. Or you go into the courtroom, excuse me, judge, these lawyers are wrong. I watched Law and Order for a couple of seasons, and I'm here to correct you, judge, and correct you, lawyers. It's the same mentality, the arrogance, the hubris of people. It's totally insane. I don't want to get off onto that, brother, sister, but I already did. God bless you guys. You know that I love you. Those people I gave a word to, I've got another list of words I'm going to try to do. When I do the words, it makes me very tired out. I don't know why. When I'm working, when I pray for people to be healed, it's the same thing. When the Holy Spirit is flowing for healing or giving somebody a word, it really wipes me out. You know, one time on a three-day on a three-day period, I personally prayed with over 1,000 people to receive the Lord one time. We had a medical mission, and I prayed with 1,000 people to receive the Lord, and all of those people came for the medical mission. I prayed with all those people to be healed. 1,000 people. And I went through about 6 different Filipino pastors. There'd be one Filipino pastor praying with me, with the person, and translating for me. They would get tired, then another one would come. I went through a cycle of about 6 different Filipino pastors, and it wiped me out. My voice was hoarse for like a week after that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'll do my best to make a new list. If you want a word from me, I ask you to email me. My email address is under every video I make in the See More. If you click on See More and, you know, and open up the section under the video, my email is there. And I'm not going to do any more words unless people email me. Now, if you're my personal friend and I know you and we've been conversating a lot through Facebook, then that will be different. But there's lots of people asking me for a word, which I want to do. It's for the Lord. And I had never spoken to you before. Email me so I can keep it more organized, you know, and then I can put it on the list. Because I'm getting requests from emails, from Facebook, from YouTube, private messaging. And it's just too, you know, it's just all over the place. So a lot of people will fall through the crack. I'm getting like, I got like 40 or 50 in the last 2 days, and then they're in all those different places. They're falling through the crack. You know, I'm going to make another video. And then if I didn't give you a word by email, a private message back, or in a video, then, you know, you have to ask me again. When I make the next video, you'll see. And then I'll say, okay, I've given everybody a word, and I don't have any more on my list. And then if you want a word, you got to email me after that. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. You know that I love you. And let's continue to run after God's heart. You know, the Lord is coming soon. I don't know when the day is, but it's soon. The Lord is coming for his bride. And the Lord just keeps giving me confirmation after confirmation. I'm not one of those confirmation people. I like to hear from the Lord in my heart. You know, that still small voice. But every once in a while, the Lord gave me confirmation. And I've been getting lots and lots of confirmations. You know, outward confirmations. That it's time, you know, either for the rapture at this moment. Or, you know, it's like World War III is going to start. And then, you know, just before the rapture. And then the Lord would send me. As I mentioned before, I felt the Lord wanted me to go to Israel. But I'm not, you know, that's how I feel. It's not been 100%. But I'm open to that, to do it. And I feel the Lord has opened me up to do that. And I'm just waiting on that. So something big is coming down that will be the short count, as they talk about with the football. Anybody knows what's the football? They have a short count for the, you know, World War III, talking about the nuclear bombs and stuff that the president would set off with the football, they call it. You know, whatever goes down, it's going to give us a short count to the rapture and the tribulation, World War III, whatever, all of how it's going to all play out. Like I say, I believe the Bible clearly teaches a pre-tribulation rapture, but that doesn't mean we won't see some things going on before the rapture, because the Lord said he would come at the midnight hour. You know, and that insinuates at the darkest point when the hall looks lost and it looks like, hey, there's not going to be a rapture, the Lord's not coming for us. You know, the tribulation's about to start. World War III's going on. You know, all hell's breaking loose. And then, boom, the Lord would cry. The cry would go out that, behold, the bridegroom cometh at the midnight hour. You know, and so someone had put in the comments on my video the other day about that song. You know, I'll wait to the midnight hour when my love would come down, waiting for the love to come down. The Lord had given me that same song a few weeks ago, maybe a month or two ago, right? Yeah, probably January. And that song. You know, wait till the midnight hour. And so it's a, you know, a blues song or whatever. But, you know, the Lord can use anything. And anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. God bless you all. I love you all. I appreciate you all. You know, when I'm preaching, it's by the Spirit of God. And, you know, a lot of times people think things personal. They think, oh, you're talking to me? No, I'm just saying what the Lord leads me to say, and just get the shotgunning it out there, you know. Shotgun blast. If it hits you, it hits you. And take it to heart. And, you know, it's a correction from the Lord. Praise God. If it's an exhortation from the Lord, praise God. Both or none. Unless for somebody else. For me, too. You know, I've heard lots of preachers say that. It's really true. A lot of times, you know, it's for the preacher also. You know, I'm being corrected and receiving stuff from what I'm saying myself. You know, so it's for everybody, even the speaker, because I'm only a vessel. Just like any true preacher, and there's lots of true, real preachers who hear from God, who flow in the Spirit of God, you know, they'll tell you that, you know, when they speak, I mean, it's they're hearing it also, you know, and they're being corrected also and getting their self straightened out, you know, because when the Spirit flows and you give utterance as the Lord leads you and proclaim His Word, you know, it's salt and light. It's a correcting force from the Lord's Spirit and His Word. God bless you guys. Love you.